I'm going to speak to you on dana, seed, and bhavana. Dana in Pali means the charitable giving of something one possesses to the poor or worthless through pity or respect. This is a virtue practiced in a countless number of births by all wise and great men, like those who aspire to be Buddhas and Arhats, enlightened beings. It is the foremost of all noble qualities and the first of the 10 perfections, Lapta-parami, which all seekers of enlightenment have to practice. Dana is the first of the 10 qualities of a righteous monarch, Dattaraja-dhamma, the first of the 4 kinds of service towards others, Sattari-sangha-vattu, and it is also the first of the 3 meritorious deeds, Dana, Sila, Bhavana. As all lay people should necessarily practice this virtue of giving, the Buddha named it Giri-dhamma, lay virtue. Dana is threefold, namely, Anisa Dana, the giving of material gifts, Anisa Dana. Then there is Abhe Dana, the gift of fearlessness, peace and happiness and security from danger. That is Abhe Dana. Then there is Dhamma Dana, the gift of the Dhamma, the teaching of the Buddha. Anisadana, or giving of material things, includes giving of food, water, clothing, transport, shelter, furniture, medicine, etc. Abhyadana is observed by refraining from the 5 demeritorious deeds of killing, stealing, sexual misconduct, lying, and the partaking of intoxicants. That is Abhyadana. The very observance of the 5 precepts gives peace and happiness to all living beings. He who observes the 5 precepts gives peace and happiness to all living beings, extends his love and compassion to all, and helps those in distress. Abhyadana has therefore been extolled as superior to Anisadana. The world today needs Abhyadana most, and it can be practiced by even the poorest and the helpless. The greatest gift of all is the giving of the Dhamma, and it includes the imparting of knowledge and instruction that are conducive to progress both in this and in the birth to come through direct teaching, publications, etc. Sabdadanam, Dhammadanam, Vinati, the gift of truth, excels all other gifts, said the Buddha. A wise man gives with confidence of the results of a good deed, with deference, with humility and respect, with a liberal heart, at an opportune time, and without hurting oneself or others. In giving a gift with confidence, whenever the full result of that action ripens, there comes wealth and beauty. In giving a gift with deference, there comes wealth, relatives, friends, and servants to care for him. The act of giving should be done with respect to the recipient, with humility and with joy and happiness. In giving with a liberal heart, there comes wealth and full enjoyment. In giving at the opportune time, wealth, etc., comes to him also in good times, and in giving without hurt to self and others, Whenever the full result of that gift ripens, there comes wealth, riches and great prosperity, and never from anyone or any source comes loss with property. Fires, floods or drought, unrighteous rulers, robbers and undesirable heirs will not harm. Giving is of value when it is timely. Giving to visitors, the poor and the worthy, those about to proceed on a journey, to the sick and the convalescent in times of distress, and giving the first produce of the harvest to the virtuous. The giver of food gives life, beauty, happiness, strength and understanding, and gains in return the very same five fruits in the cycle of existence. Thus said the Blessed Monk, if beings knew, as I know, the fruits of sharing food with others, they would never eat alone. Their hearts would not be obsessed by the taint of stinginess. Even if it be their last bit, their last morsel of food, they would not eat it without sharing it if there were anyone to receive it. But inasmuch, monks, as beings do not know, as I know, the good effect of sharing food, therefore they eat alone, and the taint of stinginess taints their heart. The giver is glad before the gift is made. In the very act of giving, he is glad, he is happy, and when he has given, he rejoices. For the moment, his mind is free from lust, hate, and delusion. When the giving is as above, the merit that occurs is indeed great, reckonable and immeasurable. The good effects of giving are visible in his very existence. The giver is dear and pleasing to everyone. Good and wise people befriend him. Fame and renown is his. And he is of good repute, perfectly confident and happy, he enters society. After death, he is reborn in happy state. Dana, or giving, therefore, is an absolute necessity to ameliorate the condition not only of the human race, but also of all other living beings. Man must live to serve and not exploit or harm others. That he must live for the good and happiness of the whole world is the instruction of the Buddha. So, practice dana according to your strength. Now, son, I am going to speak on sila. Sila, or virtue, is the initial stage of the path of purification shown under the headings of sila, samadhi and panya. Sila is virtue, samadhi is concentration, and panya is understanding or knowledge. Purity of word and deed is sila. Purity of word and deed is sila. Purity of thought comes from concentration and understanding. The Pali word sila is translated in English as virtue. What is virtue? It is a non-transgression by body or speech of the precepts of virtue that are undertaken, and the performing of one's duty towards others. Refinement in speech and action is the characteristic of virtue. Banishing evil speech and action is its function. Blamelessness in virtuous men is its achievement. It is manifested or may be apprehended as bodily purity and verbal purity. Sense of shame and fear to do evil is its proximate cause. When shame and fear to do evil are in existence, virtue arises and persists. And when they are not, it neither arises nor persists. Virtue can be divided into two kinds, of thinking and avoiding. Fulfilling a training precept announced by the Buddha that gift of design is thinking, not doing what is prohibited by him, that it should not be done, is avoiding. According to the former aspects of virtue, parents have to refrain their children from evil and establish them in all that is good and noble, see to their education and success in life. Children have to honor and respect their parents. Teachers must teach them and instruct their pupils properly and must be respected in return. A man should be courteous, true and respectful to his wife, be unthinking in providing her needs and be ready to hand her authority in the home in return for faithfulness and the proper performance of her household duties. Friends should be generous, courteous, kindly, benevolent, helpful and faithful to one another. Masters should assign servants tasks according to their strength, feed and pay them, look after them in their illness, share luxuries with them and give them adequate leave. Servants should rise before and retire after the master. Be content, do their work well and appreciate the virtues of their employers. A layman should minister to monks and Brahmins by deeds, words and thoughts of loving kindness, by welcoming them gladly and supplying their requisites. And the monks and the ascetics should restrain the laymen from evil, encourage them to do good, have a kindly heart towards them and teach them well. The other aspect of virtue is first, refraining from killing living beings, laying aside the cudgel and the sword, having shame to hurt others, and full of compassion, one lives with deep feeling and kindness for all living creatures. The second is refraining from taking what has not been given, living aloof from grasping. What is not his own, he takes only what is given and passes his life in honesty and purity of heart. Third is refraining from sexual misconduct. He is chaste. He holds aloof from things of the flesh, unlawful and unfit. Further, fourth is refraining from lying, keeping aloof from falsehood. He serves not from the truth, faithful and trustworthy. He breaks not the word to the world. Fifth is refraining from strong drinks, which tend to intoxication and heedlessness. One who practices virtue does so out of love and compassion to the whole world. Virtue is a soothing balm to the ailing world. Man, devoid of virtue, is a menace to society. The individual as well as society suffers. Killing leads to states of woe, and when born as a human being, the last of the evil results of taking life, the shortening of one's life. Similarly, stealing leads to states of woe, and the least evil result when born as a human being is a loss of wealth. Sexual misconduct leads one to states of woe, and the least evil result when born as a human being is a large number of enemies. Lying leads to states of woe, and the least evil result when he gains human birth is being the target of groundless accusation. Taking strong drinks leads to states of woe, and the very frightening result is birth as a lunatic when born as a human being. Keeping these five precepts of virtue, one gains five benefits. As a result of diligence, he comes into a large fortune. His fame spreads When he enters an assembly of the laity or clergy, he does so without fear or hesitation. He dies unconfused, calm. After death, he is reborn in a happy state. One who keeps the Panchasila or the five precepts of virtue gains five streams of merit, resulting in happiness both here and the world beyond. One who keeps the Panchasila or the five precepts of virtue gains five streams of merit, resulting in happiness both here and the world beyond. He who practices virtue gives to unnumbered beings boundless fearlessness, amity and goodwill, and in turn becomes a partaker of boundless fearlessness, amity and goodwill. In short, he enjoys unfathomable peace and happiness. This virtue is the starting point of culture, which culminates in enlightenment, the highest wisdom and the incomparable bliss, Nibbana.
Naparisaṁ ilomāni, naparisaṁ katā-katāṁ, attanova avekīya katāni akatānita. Let not one seek
others' fault, things done and undone by others, but one's own deeds done and undone. One should not give thought to gossip, hearsay, and scandalous talk. Speaking ill of others only shows the restlessness of the mind of that individual. It is a vice to belittle or run down others. It is a grievous crime to accuse innocent and virtuous people. Such accusation is forbidden ground according to the all-compassionate teacher of the Buddha. It is far better to take stock of ourselves and eliminate the evil greediness and develop all that is noble and good in us.
Yuknato mitto yo sada apipamatto bhedanu tanti randhanivanu patti yakmintya seti urativa putito tave mitto yo padeni adhiyo.